begin with a word of prayer.
Yeah.
Father, we come before you tonight and we thank you for all you have done. Thank you so much for the gift of your Son at Christmas time and for the gift of eternal life that that brought. We just praise you tonight and we want to bring glory and honor to you this evening. I thank you for each child here, each student, the families, and I ask that tonight they feel your presence in a special way and over this Christmas season. Please fill them with joy. Thank you so much for your love for us and for this special evening. In your name, amen.
All right, well, we're getting ready to have a larger number to start with. I would like to add my welcome to you guys tonight. I'm glad you could come. And I just wanted to give a couple of comments on some things that are coming up during the evening. Some of you may know this already, but our theme for the year has to do with the focus on the arts. This is a school-wide focus. We've talked about the composers and artists in chapel, and that's going to be ongoing throughout the year. When I first walked into my office, this new location, I couldn't move a thing. It was just like wall to wall, filing cabinets, everything. It just been unloaded on the semi-trucks. And I found that there were some things in my office that I didn't know the music department owned at all. And some things have been stored in the South Building. And one of the things that I found was this book called The Spiritual Lives of the Great Composers. And I've been reading in the book, have started sharing with some of the kids about that. And we're going to be doing more in the coming months. But it's written by Patrick Cavanaugh. And he's written this book as a result of 5 years of study. This information comes mainly from the letters of the composers who've written or from family members and friends who wrote to the composer. And his book focuses on the composer's faith. And he reminds us that they're mere men, just like us, who have many anecdotes about their conceit, their tempers, their financial troubles, and many failures. But like us, their failures and shortcomings did not define them. Mr. Cavanaugh states that the essence of this writing, however, is not about what they did, but what they believed. And he wrote that the chapters conclude with some personal thoughts.
Thank you. Thank you. It may be difficult to appreciate the struggles that threaten to make the story far shorter. In Hannah's case especially, had he not possessed an amazing ability to bounce back from repeated disaster, such well-loved works as The Messiah and The Royal Fireworks Museum would never have been made. How often Hannah must have felt like giving up. What if the depression his many failures would have caused an average composer? To a man who knew he had but one great talent, seeing that talent go unrewarded so often must have been profoundly perplexing. And to see other London composers, whom he knew to have less genius than himself, enjoying the success that eluded him for so many years, this must have driven Handel to extreme exasperation. Yet through all the frustrating years before his final successes, Handel simply refused to quit. As if blows inflicted by his competitor were not painful enough, Handel suffered from an onslaught of attacks within his own camp. For a devoted Christian to have come under censure by the principal church of his time must have been bitterly distressing. Even after Messiah was becoming well known as a great religious figure as John Newton, the composer of the hymn Amazing Grace, preached every Sunday for a year against the secular performances of this biblical oratorio. Yet Handel did not respond by counterattacking his Anglican brothers. Though he remained a Lutheran, he would often speak of it as one of the great felicities of his life, that he was settled in a country where no man suffers any molestation or inconvenience on account of his religious principles. Handel refused to be deterred by setbacks, attacks, illnesses, or even severe financial woes. It is a tribute to the faith and optimism that Handel possessed, relying on God as he worked to overcome significant obstacles and to create music that is universally cherished.
Show me. Thank you. that the difference between a successful man and a failure is not the number of problems each may have, but the fact that the successful man takes action to overcome his problems. Mozart was a man of action and enthusiasm. The many volumes of his compositions show us that he spent his 35 years achieving, not content to sit and rest on the laurels of a childhood career. Mozart was a sensation as a prodigy, yet as a man, he was surrounded by depressing misfortunes. The very genius that could have resulted in his success caused intense jealousy among rival composers, some of whom openly worked for Mozart's ruin. He was never given the well-paid position that he obviously deserved. His last decade was a continual struggle against poverty for himself and his dearly beloved family. If he had been inclined to discouragement, he had enough affliction to completely paralyze his musical output. Yet his response was the very opposite of paralysis. When the pressures of money mismanagement were overpowering him, Mozart would tear headlong into a brilliant new composition. When he saw other composers winning the public and denouncing his works, he would begin anew, writing innovative works that would eventually eclipse his competitors' best efforts. A lesser man might have allowed his bitter predicaments to stifle his imagination, but Mozart sustained his enthusiastic drive even through the debilitating suffering of his last year. Ultimately, generations have received the benefit of thousands of Mozart's works because he simply refused to be a slave to the circumstances around him. When he obtained a commission, he quickly fulfilled the request. But even when he went without such an incentive, he continued to create masterpieces such as his last great symphonies, composed without commission or even the prospect of an upcoming performance. The stupendous number of his compositions proves that action is the best remedy for discouragement. As long as he could compose, he was incapable of despair. His indefatigable spirit, which was cultivated as a successful prodigy, had taught him to find his motivation internally, with or without impetus of praise from others. Mozart left behind not only an unparalleled legacy of musical treasure, but a record of 18th century fame. A genius such as Mozart, possessed, developed so fully in so young man, many have tempted others to spiritual indifference. Mozart leaves evidence of a different response. He wrote in a letter, "Let us put our trust in God and console ourselves with the thought that all is well, if it is in accordance with the will of the Almighty, as He knows best what is profitable and beneficial to our temporal happiness and our eternal salvation."
Thank you. copy of mine. When asked the secret of his genius, he answered simply, "I was made to work. If you are equally industrious, you will be equally successful." It is doubtful whether anyone in the world of music has matched Bach's industriousness. When his multitudinous scores were finally collected and published, the job took the Bach Gesellschaft 46 years, and the completed edition filled 60 huge volumes. Yet all of his composing took place while Bach was fulfilling dozens of other tasks, working as an organist, a conductor, a music director, a private instructor, even a teacher of Latin to young boys, not to mention raising a large family and moving from post to post. The inspiration and beauty of his music are abundantly apparent, yet the real mystery of Bach's life as a composer concerns how he found the actual time to write it all, and still more, to have created so many masterpieces cherished through the ages. Bach personified the German Protestant work ethic. "I was made to work" could have been his life motto. Yet he was never known to speak a word of complaint. On the contrary, he seemed to have reveled in the decades of musical toil, dating from the time he copied forbidden compositions at night, and even in his final years of life, after an operation left him sightless. Bach worked frantically to revise his great choral fantasies. Bach's devotion to God and his drive to express that devotion musically gave the world a gift for all to appreciate. His productivity forced a musical legacy that Richard Wagner would someday appraise as the most stupendous miracle in all music. Thank you.
Thank you to all of you. It's nice to see you all there.